progress.
Let's begin with a word of prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we are so very thankful for the Sabbath. We're thankful for your Holy Spirit that speaks to our hearts still. And we are thankful for the people that are searching for truth and light. We're thankful for each person who participates in these studies, who is part of this movement, looking for truth, and seeking to enter into covenant with you. And we just ask, Lord, that as we open your word together, that the things that we study will lead to this end. We pray, Lord, for this movement. We know that some of the things that we will study here this evening are contentious. And we just ask, Lord, that no party spirit can take over. We ask, Lord, that the understanding will come from you, that you can lead us as you have in the past. Be with each person in their particular struggles and trials. And be with us individually as we seek you. And be with us as a group, that you can unite our hearts through thy Spirit. Be with us now. Give a special blessing on this Sabbath, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, happy Sabbath, everyone. And I put this picture up here just to show, just to kind of go back and look at why we're doing this study. So a number of weeks ago, Colin presented this study dealing with Donald Trump being the eighth president, or being the eighth head. And we've dealt with this by looking at a number of different studies. We went back to Odilio's study dealing with another parallel, which would be the emperors, the first seven emperors of Rome. We looked at a study by a guy named Ralph Myers, who sadly passed away last year. But he was dealing with the seven heads as being the names of the popes since 1798 and adding up or counting the numbers of their name. So it's not the typical view of the popes where you have seven popes. He wasn't doing it that way. He was taking the names of the popes in 1798 and coming up with the number of their names being 666. And then we looked at Revelation 12 and 13. Individually, we did studies on that. And in those studies on Revelation 12 and 13, and somebody's mic is on, I don't know. So getting some noise. People check their mic. It could be there. Thank you. For some reason, I couldn't switch that off. So when we deal with these, the understanding of Revelation 12, 13, and 17, it brought us back to the pioneer understanding of these prophecies. Now, just as a quick review of what Colin was teaching, or what he is teaching, is he took Daniel chapter 3 and recognized that this is the Sunday law. So we have an image, which in Daniel 2 is Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, Rome, and divided Rome, right, going all the way to the end. And then we see that in Daniel chapter 3, we have this golden image, and this golden image then is that power. That is, it's the Sunday law. Now, he uses our understanding of Daniel chapter 11, verses 1 and 2, that talk about the kings of Persia. So he's going to say Persia is the United States, And since this is the Sunday law, this image is going to represent the United States because the United States is the Sunday law. Now, of course, we know that this is Babylon, but Babylon, of course, becomes conquered by Persia. So he's going to take these presidents, which we had, which is there shall be yet three that stand up in Persia. So when we're looking at here, Ronald Reagan lines up with Darius, the Mede. And just hang on a second here. Okay, so so Ronald Reagan lines up with Darius the Mede, and George Bush Sr. lines up with Cyrus. So that's at the time of the end, beginning the three decrees. And then you're going to have Clinton would line up with Cambyses, George Bush Jr. would line up with False Smerdis, Barack Obama would line up with Darius the Persian, and then Trump would be the fourth, which is far richer than them all, and he's Xerxes. And he's going to stir up all against the realm of Grecia. What that means is he's going to rally his forces against Greece. He's not stirring up Greece, which somebody had been talking about in one of the studies. He's not stirring any up. He's not like stirring up a hornet's nest or anything like that. He's going to stir up all against the realm of Grecia. And that is the Book of Esther, chapter 1. And I'm just going to go there because this is an important point. Because we spent a lot of time going through the Book of Esther as well in our studies. And this is shown up in some of the WhatsApp discussions, at least references to this. So when we go to the Book of Esther, we have this king's banquet, right? We know that it's going to be 180 days that Xerxes is going to have this feast. And what he's doing is he's going to the princes or the leaders of these 27 provinces, and he's having this continual feast. That is, they're not all there the whole time. They're probably going to be there on the first day of the first month when this feast begins, which is the Akitu festival. That's a Babylonian festival that was still practiced by Persia as well. So on the first day of the first month, they're going to begin this feast. And during this time, he's trying to stir all up, all of his kingdom, against the realm of Grecia. That is, he's trying to get support, financial and military support, to go against Greece. Now, and then he's going to have this first period is 180 days. So let me see here. Then it's going to be, so it says, even 104 score days. When he showed the riches of his glorious kingdom and the honor of his excellent majesty many days, even 104 score days. So he's going to have these nobles, princes of the provinces being there, but not all at the same time. He's going to be working through that period of time with different people. And when these days were expired, so when the 180 days end, the king made a feast unto all the people that were present in Shushan the palace, both unto the great and small, 7 days in the court of the garden of the king's palace. Now, there's a bunch of symbolism here. This tessellation here, this there were white, green, blue hangings fastened with cord of fine linen and purple and silver rings and purple pillars of marble. The beds were gold and silver upon a pavement of red, blue, white, and black marble. And I actually had seen, they've actually found this pavement. And I've seen a picture of it once, but I can't find it again. This is a tessellated tiles. So it's in a pattern. And just like we see in the story of Belshazzar, that is, they're going to have this feast, and it's in the fall, it's in the seventh month, and it's the fall Akitu festival. So they start on the first day of the first month in the spring, and then they end in the fall, usually on the 16th day of the 10th month. But in this case, it's going to be, or the the 16th day of the seventh month. In this case, it's going to be the 10th day of the seventh month. It's going to be on a Sabbath, and this that this occurs, and it's 187 days. And we can see it's in the symbol of 180 and 7. So that's a symbol of what?
July 18th.
It's July 18th. And we have Xerxes here, who is Trump, who's stirring up all against the realm of Grisha. Right? So when Vashti, her refusal, and we still have to come back to this. We've studied Esther, but as we continue studying other things, we keep coming back to this story. So we're not going to address the story of Vashti here, except to say that the story of Vashti is going to occur on the Day of Atonement. So it says on the seventh day, right? So that's going to be 187th day, right? But it's a symbol of July 18th in the time of Trump. And so July 18th occurs in the time of Donald Trump, of Xerxes, when he's stirring up all against the realm of Grisha. Now, so when we look at Xerxes, when we look at these kings, and I'm going to go to this. So okay, got all these different. Okay, so here's one. So we can see.
Just have a quick question.
Yep. Okay.
So in verse 9, when we were studying this back in the day, a few years ago, mm-hmm. In verse 9, where it says, also Vashti the queen made a feast for the women. I have written here from my studies that the feast was at the same time. So the 187 wouldn't have been linear days, sequential days, if we're following that logic. So I just wanted to bring that out.
Okay, you have to explain. The 187 days is continuous.
Well, I'm just saying that at the time when we studied it out before, years ago, when we were doing the study on Esther with FFA, verse 9 says also, and at the time we took it as a doubling because it was a feast at the same time for the women of the people that the king was entertaining, and it was concurrent with the 180 days. That's what I have from that.
It would actually put that out there. So, it would actually occur with the 7 days, so not with the 180 days. Right. So during the period of the 7 days.
No, that the feast. I thought the Vashti's feast was. Okay.
It's for
so whatever.
Days.
Yeah, I just.
Yeah, it's for 7 days. So because we're already in the 7 days period in this verse. So they first have the 180 days. And after the 180 days, they're going to have the 7 day feast. And during that 7 day feast, Vashti is also going to have a feast for the women. So that's going to be concurrent with the 7 day feast, not with the 180 feast.
Got it. The 7 day feast in verse 5. Yeah, that's feast number 2. Okay, very good. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, thanks for that. So now there's a number of things, and just going back to how we were understanding this when we first studied this, because that would have been in 2015, if I remember correctly, at the end of 2015 into 2016. There was, and I believe it was in 2015 in the fall, that there was a dispute, or maybe it was in the spring. It might have been in the spring camp meeting. I wasn't there, but there was a many people who left the movement over the idea that Vashti represented a bad symbol, and that Esther represented a good symbol, because morally, Vashti is the one that's morally superior to Esther. We could look at a lot of faults that Esther has. One is she's in captivity still when she shouldn't be, and she's also going to become, the wife of a pagan king, where Vashti is standing for truth, because they're actually asking her to appear before the men which would be improper. And so she refuses. But be that as it may, there's a whole bunch of things about the story of Esther that we just didn't see before, that we can understand now because of July 18th. So you can see back at that time, they wouldn't have understood the significance of July 18th in 2015. And also they didn't seem to understand that it began on the first day of the first month and ended on the 10th day of the seventh month. They knew, though, that it had something to do with the period from the first day of the first month to the 10th day of the seventh month, because they knew that was 187 days. So they had some ideas back then, but they hadn't put it all together. So I brought this chart up here anyway. So I wanted to go back to this, or to this. So we can see just visually Darius the Mede, Cyrus, and then the three that shall stand up, and the fourth is Xerxes. And you can see on the bottom, we have these numbered as with Darius to Darius is not going to be counted because he's not a king of Persia. He's a Median king. So Cyrus is going to be the first king of Persia. And so these are the first seven kings of Persia: Cyrus, Cambyses, Falsemyrnus, Darius, Xerxes, who's also called Ahasuerus in the Book of Esther, Artabanus, and then Artaxerxes. Now, when we look at the American presidents below that, notice we don't have anybody listed after Trump, because this is an old chart. So this chart I made way back in 2015. Now, so we're going to deal with the five are fallen, one is. So if we were going to look at the five are fallen, we're going to count from Reagan as one. At least this is what is being done by Colin. So he's going to look at Reagan as the first one, Bush as the second, Clinton as the third, Bush the second as the fourth, Obama as the fifth. The one is Trump. Or is he going to go from here? So I think he's going to go here, pardon me. So I think he's going to put the one that is Biden, right? So I got that backwards. So again, he's not going to count Reagan. He's going to count these. And then the one that's yet to come, isn't that how he's doing it or not?
I think you've got it figured correctly.
Okay. So
basically what he's been trying to do is to count Reagan and Bush as one.
Right. So he, okay. But then, okay, let me just look at his diagram here. Yeah. So he's going to count Reagan and Bush. So I'm going to go over here. Yeah, I was right the first time. So Reagan and Bush are one. So that's part of the thing, is he's not going to deal with the five are fallen. The one is Trump. So he's going to have Trump as the one that is. And then Joe Biden's going to be the seventh. And then Donald Trump again will be the eighth.
It's the placement where he's coming in with Joe Biden as Raphia. But then also when you're looking at this, he's going Reagan, Bush, yet, and then going Clinton, Bush second, Obama, and Trump.
Right. So that's going to be Daniel chapter 11, verse 1 and 2. Right. That part, this count here. So Trump's the fourth. But in the context of the riddle, and so we're going to look at this. We're going to look at the riddle in Revelation 17 and try to look at the riddle as it applies to other periods of seven kings and see if we can make this fit. So he's chosen one, which is the first seven kings of Persia. But we also have other histories that we need to lay over top of this. So now the Raphia, we put January 6th, 2021 as a typical Raphia. That is the king of the North is going to lose to the king of the South. The South are the Democrats, the North are the Republicans. So we're going to compare this with the Civil War as well. And then we're going to see that, according to that model, in Paneum, you're going to see the King of the North is going to put an end to the King of the South. So that's the other argument that he's using. He's using this King of the North, King of the South model that we get from the book of Daniel and from the story of Raphi and Paneum.
And I just make I just want to not forget that we're dealing with this image of gold, which is the theme of worship.
Yeah, well, this is the Sunday law, which is about false worship. Yeah.
Right.
So
yeah.
Now the question is, can we do this? Can we take, and what he's doing is he's taking the Revelation 17. The idea that we have is that the seven heads represent Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, and Rome. And so in a sense, he's laying over top of this golden image, the image of Daniel chapter 2. And he's using that to tie it to the riddle of Revelation 17. And I know this is rather involved, and we're taking our time with this. We're not really drawing a lot of conclusions. That is, we need to understand if we can apply the riddle in this way. Now, so we have this. So I'm just going to quickly go through these different lines that we have to address. So we have this line, which is Persia and the United States. But we also have the last seven kings of Judah. And these are connected with the four seven times. Now, when we look at this here, we can see that there are seven kings. These are the last seven kings of Judah, beginning with Manasseh. And then we have Ammon, and then Josiah, then Jehoahaz, Jehoiakim, Jehoiachin, Zedekiah. Now, could we apply the riddle of five are fallen, one is, and one is yet to come, to these seven kings? You see what I'm asking here?
I don't see why not.
Okay, well, if we were to do that, the five that are fallen would be Manasseh, Ammon, Josiah, Jehoahaz, Jehoiakim. And then Jehoiachin would be the one that is. Now, Jehoiachin reigns for three months and 10 days. And so if that is the case, that he's the one that is, then Zedekiah is the one that's yet to come. That will continue a short space. But who would be the eighth? Okay, so remember, this is the line of David. So after Zedekiah, which is the next king?
Well, if you're applying the riddle, it would have to be of the seven.
Okay, yeah, have to be of the seven. And that's what we need to understand, is what does it mean of the seven? So there's a lot of little pieces we have to address. So we know that none of these kings are ever going to come into power again, particularly. We do know, we could argue, that Jehoiachin, he's going to be taken into captivity, but he's the one that is, right? And 36 years after that, he's going to be released from prison, but he doesn't become the king of Judah again. But we know that when Zedekiah is killed, there's a prophecy that says, I will overturn it until he come whose right it is. And what's the overturning? Does anybody remember what Ellen White, how she applies the overturning? Which power brings an end to Zedekiah, to the kings of Judah?
Babylon, isn't it?
Babylon. So then it's going to be overturned to who?
Media Persian.
And then overturned to who?
To Greece.
And overturned to who?
Rome.
And then who's going to come? Who's right it is?
Christ.
Christ. So Christ is the eighth here. And the eighth is a symbol of the resurrection. But here, we're not looking at a counterfeit power. We're not looking at a pagan power. We're looking at a godly power, even though, you know, this is the line of David. And so we can see with the last seven kings that we can take this and create this reform line. And then Christ is going to be the eighth. But there's going to be this overturning that occurs in their captivity. So you got Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, and Rome, these four. And then Christ comes. And I've shown other places that you can go to the book of Zechariah, and you can show this, that these are the chariots, the four chariots, Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, and Rome. And Christ comes after this progressive destruction of four. Now, do we have a time of the end in this list of these seven kings? Does Manasseh mark a time of the end?
The beginning of a time of the end, yes.
Okay, so it's the time of the end in the context of what prophecy?
Isaiah 7, isn't it?
Yeah, so Isaiah 7, the 65-year prophecy. So Manasseh is taken captive and fulfills that prophecy at the time of the end. Now, we know this is part of a progressive destruction of four as well. It is, I have the mark there. The pride of the power broken, that's Manasseh's captivity. While beasts robbing them of their children, that's Jehoiachin, that's Daniel's captivity, or Jehoiakim, pardon me. And then Jehoiachin is the siege and the famine. And then Zedekiah is a repeat of the first three. That's when the temple is destroyed. Again, brought into captivity. That's the end of the kingship, right? So all of those things, the end of the temple, the kingship, and there's 49 years left from the time that the temple is destroyed until the end of that period. So in 537, when Cyrus comes to the throne. So we can connect this actually quite interestingly. This prophecy here is connected, because this is the progressive destruction of four, which is going to lead to the reform line of the three decrees. Now, we're going to look at the last seven kings of Israel. So this is a study, again, from way back when we were doing this. So I haven't really updated it or anything. It's just the study that we had. So we have Jeroboam II, Zechariah, Shalom, Menahem, Pekahiah, Pekah, and Hoshea. Now, who is Pekah? Is there any prophecies that we could say five are fallen, one is, and one is yet to come, that would relate to this line of the kings of northern Israel? What about Isaiah chapter 7? Does this relate? Who's the king in Isaiah chapter 7 when the prophecy of Manasseh is given? The prophecy leading to the 65 years, which leads to Manasseh.
Isn't it Ahaz?
Okay, he's the king of Judah.
Right.
So the king of northern Israel is Pekah. Right?
Right.
Okay, so Pekah's the king of northern Israel. He's the king of Samaria. He's the son of Gedaliah. Not Gedaliah. The son of... what is it?
Remaliah.
Remaliah.
Yes.
Yeah, Remaliah.
Yeah, so he's the son of Remaliah, right. Okay. And so it's kind of interesting that we can look at these kings where we have this prophecy that's going to lead to Manasseh's captivity, that we can see that in the last seven kings that we could say five are fallen. Now, the question that we have to ask, does Jeroboam the second mark a time of the end? Who's Jeroboam the second? What is his history? What is his story? Anybody remember who Jeroboam II is? Is there any interesting history in connection with him that we could mark the time of the end?
First off, he was the 13th king of Israel.
Yeah.
He was the son and successor of Joash. And he was contemporary with Amaziah and Uzziah.
Okay. So, but can we mark him as the time of the end in any way? If we're going to have the last seven kings of Israel, if we're going to say five are fallen, wouldn't we need to start from a time of time of the end?
Well, I would agree with your point. I mean, the thing is that Jeroboam the second was one that pressed even harder for the worship of other gods, especially in Dan and Bethel.
Yeah, so, I mean, he's Jeroboam the second more than just in name.
Right, he's Jeroboam the second in even further practice.
Okay, is he a repeat of history?
In a way, you could say that.
Yeah, okay, because Jeroboam, which marks the beginning of this division of the two kingdoms. Now you have Jeroboam the second. He's repeating this history. So he's a repeating of Millerite history, if we want to put it that way.
Okay, but wasn't he also one that pressed for the worship of the golden calves?
Yeah. Yeah, so that's what I'm saying is that this, when we look at the kings of Israel, they're going to symbolize that repeat of history. And we're going to see that we could then say five are fallen. And for some reason, I have them numbered the other way. Can't remember why I did that. I think I was counting backwards for some reason. I don't remember why. But if we're going to count from Jeroboam II, we could say five are fallen. One is, and so that means we'd have to be in the book of Isaiah when that prophecy for Manasseh is given. And so one is yet to come. That's going to be Hoshea. But the question is, in this one, can we say who the eighth is? Would we have any basis to say who the eighth is? And how would we tie Hoshea, who's taken captive in 723, how would we tie him with something that we would call the eighth? So you saw what we did with the kings of Judah, right? We used a prophecy about the overturn. And we could use that and apply that to Christ being the eighth. Can we do anything like that here? Because if we're going to go to Hoshea, what do we have anything that attaches him to something later?
Now, are you saying Hoshea the prophet?
Hoshea the king, right?
Okay.
So Hoshea is taken captive, right? And so we're going to have to connect him to an eighth. So this is the king of northern Israel. He's the last king of northern Israel. When he's taken captive, the 2520 for northern Israel begins, correct?
Agreed.
And when does it end?
1798.
Okay, 1798. So can we put something in 1798 that would be the eighth? That's going to be something to do with Protestantism. I mean, we can't take an individual that I can think of. But can we see that Protestantism is a restoration? The false prophet is a restoration of northern Israel.
That would be agreed.
Okay. So we could put Protestantism there. And that brings us to Millerite history. And then we're going to see that Protestantism is going to fall and become part of Babylon. Babylon has fallen. So we could do that. But notice we're not taking an individual in this case. We're not saying that we have to have one of those kings is going to come back into power again. So to be the eighth and to be of the seven isn't to be the same one of those seven. That's not what it's saying in this context, if we're going to apply the riddle here. Okay, so that's just an observation. And these are we're going to have to look into in a lot more detail. So we just kind of, I wanted to sketch that point dealing with Revelation 17 riddle. That if we can apply it, we can apply it to these individual kings. But when you get to the eighth, it's not going to be one of the persons that's going to be resurrected. So here is Revelation 17. Now, we spent a time last week reading a paper. The paper was by Bob Pickle. He's got a great name. And the paper which I sent out in email is entitled, Who Are These Seven Kings? Now, we read through it, and I commented on it, and I think we understood the position, but I'm just going to go over it again briefly. So the idea is that the pioneers did not have a position that the seven heads represented Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, and Rome, etc. The seven heads represented the seven forms of government, beginning with republicanism. And he makes an argument, which is seems to be a very valid argument, that when John is in vision, he can see things in the future. But when he's having a conversation with the angel, he's in his own time. And so when it comes to the idea that the five are fallen and one is, this is the conversation with an angel. Right? So you're going to see this here. We're going to read through this. Just to refresh our memories. There came one of the seven angels which had the seven vials and talked with me, saying unto me, come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters. So we know this is the papacy, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and ten horns. So one thing we can see is that this scarlet beast is not the same beast in Revelation 13. In Revelation 13, what we have is a composite beast that has seven heads and ten horns and ten crowns upon its horns. This beast is not going to have any crowns. Now, this woman, of course, is the papacy sitting upon this beast. We know that the beast of Revelation 13 that comes out of the sea is the papacy. So this scarlet-colored beast can't be the papacy, because the papacy can't be riding the papacy. It's committing fornication with this beast. And so this beast has to, in some way, be the state, and the woman is the church. So we can see in verse 4 and 5 who this is. This is the papacy, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots, mystery Babylon the Great. And she's a persecutory power. I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. Now we know that John here is in 1798, at the end of the time of this power. And it's going to cover this period of time up until the end. In chapter 13, he's coming up to 1798 with the rise of the United States, with the two-horned beast. But here in Revelation 17, he's beginning there at the end of that 1260, but carrying us to the end. So it's going to go much farther. I mean, in a sense, the two-horned beast is the United States, and it's going to speak as a dragon at the end. So it is covering this period as well, but it does it differently. And we'll see why this is important. So I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints, with the blood of martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. And the angel said unto me, wherefore didst thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman and the beast that carrieth her, which hath seven heads and ten horns. Now, one of the things that Bob Pickle brings out is that this beast, when it talks about the beast here, it's not talking about the beast of Revelation 13. It's talking about the scarlet-colored beast. And this beast, one of the things about this beast is that it's, what was one of the things that he said? I'm trying to find it here. So, where is this here? I think it's later. So when I get to it, I'll mention it. It's right later. The beast which that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder, whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they behold the beast that was and is not. So one of the things about this beast is it's a scarlet-colored beast, and it's got some characteristics as the great red dragon, but the great red dragon is pagan Rome, and we wouldn't argue that this beast is pagan Rome. So it's not the beast of Revelation 12, and it's not the beast of Revelation 13. It's a different beast, and it ascends out of the bottomless pit, and he makes some comparisons to this, dealing with other powers that come out of the bottomless pit that are satanic powers. And then it says, here is a mind which hath wisdom. So this is the riddle. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth. Now, one of the arguments that he makes here is that these mountains refer to the mountains or what we commonly call the hills of Rome, the seven hills of Rome. And he goes through and names those hills. So this would place that this beast is situated in Rome. Okay, so that's where this that this has to do with Rome, and the woman is sitting on this beast, right? So she's sitting upon these seven mountains or seven hills. Now, some commentaries, some people will comment and say, well, these are mountains, not hills. But of course, I would say, how do you distinguish whether something's a mountain or a hill? A mountain, what we think of mountains here in Alberta, at least, are the Rocky Mountains. They're definitely not hills. But the idea of a mountain, there's no difference. If you go to the mountains, like Mount Zion, it's really a hill. So the idea that mountains can't refer to the hills of Rome, I think would be wrong. Now, we know that these mountains, though, are symbolic. That is, it's not so much about the hills of Rome, though it's giving us this location, but it's showing that these mountains, these seven heads represent seven mountains. And there are seven kings. Five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. Now, we had dealt with this with Revelation 13. So the pioneer view on the heads in Revelation 13 is that they're the seven forms of Roman government. And the form of Roman government that existed at the time of John is the imperial form of government, which is the emperors. The one that is not yet come is the papal form of government. And that was the pioneer's understanding, more or less. There were some different views. Miller had a different view than some of the others. So the point was, what was the seventh? Some had it as, like Miller said, it would be the ten kings represented the seventh. But it's really the papal form. That was sort of, if you look at the pioneers' writings in general, they're going to come to the conclusion that the seventh head is the papacy. And then the eighth is going to be the United States. That is, it's going to arise as one of the seven. And the United States is Republican. So the first form of Roman government, when they become a republic, is republicanism. So they're a republic in 509 BC, I think, is the date that's often given. So when they become a republic, that's one of the seven. And so the United States is going to be one of those seven forms of government. But we're also going to have 10 kings. Now, is the United Nations composed primarily of monarchies, or do we see generally in the world democratic and republican forms of government?
Just about every country right now.
Yeah, so in some form. I mean, there is dictatorships and there's here and there. Yeah. But when we talk about the United Nations in general, we're going to see that the world has abandoned monarchies, and it's democratic or republican in some form. And so the world has moved in that direction. So this is one of his other views, or his other arguments dealing with what we see, that these 10 horns that haven't received a kingdom as yet, he says the fact that they have no crowns upon them means that they're not really monarchies. Now, I've always had a different view, that is, they receive no kingdom as yet. That is, they're going to receive crowns when they receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. So we've had, a number of different views, and we have to sort through this. But the pioneer view would be that the eighth is the United States. And what they would look at is they would look at Revelation 17 and say that this is just another description of what we see in Revelation 13. That is, Revelation 13 shows the papacy and then the two-horned power, the second beast, as the United States. And it's Republican and Protestant. So it's this rise of Protestantism that now is at the end of the papal period that's going to be tested under the first angel's message. And Protestant horn is going to fall. And in the repeat of history at the end of time, the Republican horn falls. And that's going to happen before the Sunday law itself. You have to have the Republican horn fall prior to there being a Sunday law. And so what we have is this illustration of the papacy going to the United States, and the United States is going to make an image to the beast. And that's of course going to be about Sunday worship and the church and state combined. So when we go to Revelation 17, then, this is illustrating Revelation 13 in a different way. Instead of seeing the woman, or instead of seeing the papacy as a beast, we're going to see this differentiated by the woman being the papacy and this other beast that she's going to be riding, committing fornication with. And that there's going to be these forms of government, seven heads, five are fallen, one is. Well, that's in the context of when John is writing. So the view that was understood by the pioneers is that John is brought to the future and sees in vision something in the future. But when he has a conversation with the angel, he's in his own time. So we can't say the five are fallen are Babylon and Media, Persia, Greece, Rome, pagan, and Rome papal, according to the pioneers, because the conversation's happening in the first century. So this is what we understood from the pioneers. Now, the question is, and that we're going to be looking at in a lot more detail,
I have a question, though.
Okay. Yeah.
Then why are the Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, pagan Rome, paper Rome on the charts? That's the pioneers did the charts.
Not with the Revelation 17 head. So Revelation 17, they don't label the heads that way. That was something much, much later. And actually the idea has really been popularized by Roy Allen Anderson. So it's,
yeah, but the pioneers still had that view, though.
No, they didn't. That's what I'm trying to say, is they didn't have that. So they didn't.
Are you talking about Sister White, where she wrote that if you're going to talk about what's the first one, Assyria, and then Israel, because she makes that point as well. If you're going to change like from that. The standard one that is on the charts, then you have to include Assyria and Israel.
Okay, so what I'm saying is
I can't remember the sequence.
So we have no problem with Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, and Rome when it comes to the image of Daniel chapter 2. What I'm saying is that in the beast of Revelation 17, they didn't name the heads Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, Rome, pagan Rome, papal, or anything like that. They said that they were the seven forms of Roman government. Right? So I'm not saying that, you know, we would change anything on the chart, but there's nothing on the chart with the, what they say that the seven-headed beast is, they say it's pagan Rome. And so it does represent pagan Rome in some way, but in a different way than Revelation 12. That is, it's in a different time. So we don't have the position that the seven-headed, which is on here. So on the charts, I'm just going to look at the 1843 chart. Yeah, this is the one on the chart, the seven-headed beast on the chart is pagan Rome. That's Revelation chapter 12, right? So they're going to have Revelation chapter 12 is pagan Rome. And then when they have the woman, they don't have the woman riding the beast. They have pagan Rome and papal Rome, the little horn. And then they have papal Rome as being represented by, in Revelation. That's Revelation 13. So they don't have the scarlet colored beast on the chart. And they don't label the heads Babylon.
Well, isn't that what we used to call, we would call modern Rome? We used to bring in modern Rome.
Right.
Pagan, so we modern, and then papal.
Right. So when we look at the scarlet colored beast, it's not the great red dragon, right? So the scarlet colored beast is some other power at the end of time, which we would say is modern Rome. Right, that's the way that we would place it. But all I'm saying is that when we look at the pioneer view does not label the heads as nations of the past. It looks at the heads as being the seven forms of Roman government. So that's the pioneer view. And it's something that the movement has never addressed. That is, I didn't really notice it till 2 weeks ago. So, I mean, I'd heard of it. I'd seen it, but I never paid any attention to it. I just thought, oh, they have this view and it's, you know, it's not credible. You know, we understand it differently now. But what we're doing is we're going back and we're looking at how the pioneers understood it. And we're seeing if this makes sense. And if we can see the agreement between what the pioneers taught and what God's revealed to this movement, even though we may not fully have understood the pioneers' view in the past. So does that help?
So these seven forms of government, would those be typified by what Sister White wrote about saying Assyria and then Israel?
No.
And then I'm not sure. No? Okay.
No, they're nothing to do with nations. They have to do with Rome? Because when we looked at Revelation chapter 12, we see this woman and this dragon. Right, this great red dragon, which primarily is Satan, but in a secondary sense, Ellen White says, is pagan Rome. And the heads were understood by the pioneers as being these forms of Roman government. The ten horns, they would look at as what's going to happen to pagan Rome is it's going to be divided at the end. And they take this from Daniel chapter 7. Right, and they do the same thing in Revelation 13. They're going to look at papal Rome is the period in when the 10 kings exist. But because you can see in Revelation 12, the heads have crowns, but the horns do not. Right, so in Revelation 13, the horns have crowns, but the heads do not. So it's reversed. So they recognize it's a different time that John is brought into vision. Revelation 12, he's brought to the birth of Christ and brought forward into the future to the beginning of the 1260 years. In Revelation 13, he's brought into the future to the end of the 1260 years. And in Revelation 17, he's brought into the future during the time of the Sunday law.
I kind of see it a little bit now.
Okay. So the idea that they had that it was seven forms of Roman government, you know, as I said, it's only been 2 weeks that I've been studying this and trying to understand it. And I've been studying lots of other things. So we're studying this together, really, is what we're doing. We're looking at what the pioneers said, and we're trying to say, does this make sense? And one is it solves a number of problems. One of the problems that we've always had has to do with Revelation 17, where we know that the woman is the papacy, but we haven't been able to really understand how this scarlet-colored beast, what is it? I mean, particularly, what is it? Now, we would take this view that the seven heads are Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, Rome, pagan, Rome, papal. We'd say five are fallen, One is, that's the United States, and one is yet to come, the UN. And then we would say, well, there's going to be an eighth, and the eighth is of the seven. So we would say the papacy is resurrected, and that's going to be the eighth head. And so you're going to have the United States, the UN, and the papacy all united at the end. That's what we believe. That's what we believe. I mean, whether we're going to change that, or we're going to somehow understand that maybe the pioneers were right and that we need to re-examine this, but it doesn't mean that God wasn't leading us in how we saw it, because we could look at it as a repeat of history. So just because we take the pioneer view doesn't mean we can just simply reject what God has shown us, but it does mean that we have to have an explanation. And our explanation would be, we could say the pioneers were just wrong. We could say that the pioneers were correct, but we're looking at a parallel to it, or I don't like using the word zoom in all the time, but basically we're looking at something that relates to our time specifically that the pioneers couldn't have seen, but it doesn't mean that they were wrong about what they were saying. Or we could, you know, different people come up with different ideas, you know, they're Pope's heads. And so we've looked at these things. We've looked at the different ideas that people have tried to use to explain Revelation 17. But the best explanation I've seen is what Bob Pickle presents, that which is really the pioneer view. And Uriah Smith also goes through and explains why this idea, and we looked at his briefly, why we can't use Babylon, Media, Persia, Greece, and Rome, and so forth, to name the heads, that the heads need to be these seven forms of Roman government, which he expounds on the pioneer view of how he saw it, and that we can't abandon and go to some new view. And those new views were starting to come in, not so much into Adventism, though, that was some of that. But really, these were views that other people in other churches had, and eventually those views, those Protestant views, came into Adventism. So by the time this movement began in 1989, I had never heard of the pioneer understanding of Revelation 17. And in fact, even though I slowly noticed it when I was reading stuff, really it's not till 2 weeks ago, again, as I said, that I came to understand it. And I think it's quite important that we understand what the pioneers taught, because we're supposed to go back to the old paths. We're supposed to examine the foundation. And my view and what I've seen happening so far in this movement is that when we do that, we find that the foundation was laid correctly and that there's sometimes things we have to unlearn. So.
Question?
Yeah.
Okay. When you're talking about the seven forms of Roman government, as stated by the pioneers or some of the pioneers,
yeah,
what time period is being referred to? Or is there a time period referred to? Like, are these sequential forms of government or concurrent forms of government? And well, what time period would that
be? Okay, so the time period is from the rise of the Roman Republic to the time that he's talking in, five are fallen. So that's going to be the republicanism, the republican form of government, the consular form of government, the dictators. So dictators would, that was different times. So there's different times you've had dictators. And dictators weren't bad things. They were something that you did in a time of crisis. You would temporarily make somebody a dictator. But it was always temporary. And then they had the triumvirate and the decemvirate. So sometimes they tried different forms of government. But the time in which John was writing, it was the imperial form of government. So that's the one that is. And then the papal form of government is the one that's yet to come. Now, Miller had it as the 10 kings as the form of government. So he wasn't looking so much as the papacy itself, but as the kings, the 10 kings under the, in the time of the papacy, right? So Rome is divided into these 10 nations. And so he's used it as a symbol that way, but it's somewhat similar, even whether you say it's staple form or not. But that's how the pioneers understood it. They understood it as forms of government. And we can see in the conversation that John is having with the angel, when he has a conversation, he's in the time that he's in. When he's in vision, he can be brought into the future. But the conversation is going to be in his own time. And in the paper we read last week, he clearly showed this other examples of this. So John here, when it says five are fallen, you can't look at that from our time, from 1798, and say that five are fallen and one is, being the United States. You can't do that because John is speaking from his own time when he's having this conversation. So the five that are fallen have to be fallen in John's day. Now, the other thing is we look at the wound. So when we look at the wound in Revelation 13, we know one of the heads was wounded unto death. And that would be the papal head. But in this case, the understanding of the pioneers, that wouldn't be the fifth one. It would be the seventh one. Right? So that's going to be the end of Rome, is the papacy receiving this deadly wound. And then the second beast arises, and he's going to make an image to the beast. That is, in a sense, the second beast is causing this resurrection of the papal power. So when we look at Revelation 17 and it talks about the eighth, that's not the resurrection of the papal power. That's the United States that's going to cause the world to worship the image of the beast, or the image of the beast. So that's how they would look at it. And the question is this solid? Well,
can I just?
Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt. In my mind, I'm trying to keep up, and in my mind, it's like a mixed metaphor because we're talking about the seven forms of Roman government, mm-hmm. but then you're talking about the United States. So that's a mixed metaphor in my mind.
No, so the United States is Republican. So that first form of Roman government, that's why he's of the seven. So the United States, the eighth head, is of the seven. It's not a dictatorship. It's not a consular form of government. It's not a triumvirate. It's not an emperor. It's going to be Republican. So that's what it means.
Okay, so you're saying that the eighth that resurrects is of the seven as a Republican form of government, but it has a papal nature.
Right. So it's going to be the Republican form of government. It starts out that way. It has two horns like a lamb, but it'll speak as a dragon. So it's going to make an image to the beast. That's what it says in Revelation 13. So in Revelation 17, it's just illustrating the same story, but from a different time period. That is, it starts in Revelation 13 in 1798, the rise of the United States. In Revelation 17, it's going to deal with the end, with the Sunday law period itself, the time in which we're in. But when the conversation between John and the angel occurs, John is still in his own time. That is, the five are fallen are relative to John's day. So we've looked at it in a particular way, and it's hard to unlearn sometimes. I know this, I teach guitar. When somebody has a way of thinking, their brain goes through a certain path, and it takes time to go over this again and again. So that's why I recommend people read Bob Pickle's paper, prayerfully and carefully. But when you start to look at it, and there are some things I disagree with him about, just because we understand some things in this movement that he doesn't understand. But they're not major. They don't change the overall argument. So when he looks at this scarlet-colored beast, he can see that this has to be something different at the end of time. Now, the seven heads and the ten horns are brought together because all of these beasts in some way represent a form of Rome. Pagan Rome, papal Rome, modern Rome. But here in modern Rome, we're not dealing with the Catholic Church because the woman is riding this beast. So modern Rome has to be something different than papal Rome and something different than pagan Rome. And we know that this beast has seven heads and ten horns. So it's modeling itself after pagan Rome and papal Rome, that all these beasts have these seven heads. But in this case, when John is explained this, that five are fallen, one is, and one's yet to come, the papal Rome, there's going to be this eighth. Just as in Revelation 13, this two-horned beast is going to arise from the earth, this eighth is the United States that arises. It is a form of government that is Republican, so it's of the seven. And this would make sense. I mean, this makes lots of sense, especially as you spend time looking at the chapter itself, what's happening here. So we can see that it's going to talk about this scarlet-colored beast, and it calls it a scarlet-colored beast. So this is not the beast of Revelation 13, which is the beast. And it's going to make this distinction. So this scarlet-colored beast always has these clarifying statements of who it is. Now, when it talks about the beast that thou sawest was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition, and they that dwell on the earth shall wonder whose names are not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world when they behold the beast that was and is not. So the question is, the beast that thou sawest that was and is not, where does this come from? What's being talked about here? Is this the beast of Revelation 13 that's being referred to?
About the one with the deadly wound?
Okay. So one of the things is we have a way of thinking about this that we're going to have to, if we're going to look at the pioneer view, we'd have to understand how they saw it first. So the beast that was is not and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit. So in this context, this must be the scarlet-colored beast, would it not? So this is not the beast of Revelation 13, even though commentaries are going to bring us back to that beast. Because this beast ascends out of the bottomless pit. And it shall ascend out of the bottomless pit. Right? So it was, is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit. So we're going to have to try to understand what that's talking about. And shall go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder whose names were not written in the book of the life from the foundation of the world when they behold the beast that was and is not and yet is. So this can't be referring to the papacy. Or can it? How do we understand this? In the context of the pioneer.
What about Revelation 9, verse 11?
Yes. So 9, verse 11 is going to be dealing with another power that comes because this is going to be this power that comes out of the bottomless pit, right? Which is Islam. What about,
right? Yeah, that's what I just said. Revelation 9, verse 11.
Yeah, so we have Islam comes out of the bottomless pit. So what does it mean to come out of the bottomless pit? He deals with that in the paper as well.
Well, land of a desert, land of pits.
Okay. Desert. Well, this is a satanic power. So the bottomless pit refers to Satan's abode, right? So we have different things that come out of the bottomless pit, and we can say that Islam comes out of the bottomless pit. It's a satanic power.
Yeah.
So we don't find that with Revelation 13. The beast there comes out of the sea.
Yeah.
Right? Okay.
Yeah.
And in Revelation 17, this beast would come out of the bottomless pit. So it's a power at the end of the world. So it's not the papacy, because the woman is the papacy. And it's not pagan Rome, though it is related to pagan Rome, because it is Rome, but it's modern Rome. So then it says, here's the mind which hath wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth. So the seven mountains, these are the seven hills of Rome. The woman sits upon the seven hills of Rome. And there are seven kings. Now, this is not referring to kings, even though it says seven kings. And it's not referring to kingdoms. It's referring to the seven different forms of government, according to the pioneers. Five are fallen, one is not yet come. So when he cometh, he must continue a short space. Now, that's 1260 years. Short space doesn't mean a short space in the sense that we would think of it, but it's a very specific period of time. It's short in the context of the bigger time prophecies. The beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth and is of the seven and goeth into perdition. So we're going to see that this is talking about the United States, but when the United States speaks as a dragon, correct? Wouldn't that be what it's talking about? If we're going to say that this is the United States, as the pioneers do, this would be, so this beast that the woman's going to be riding at the end of the world is going to be the two-horned beast of Revelation 13 when it's made an image to the beast. And if it's made an image to the beast, can you not see that this beast here, the scarlet-colored beast, is the image to the beast? Anybody with thoughts on that?
So are you saying the scarlet-colored beast is a form of government and is an image?
Yeah. So the United States is going to form an image to the beast. And we see now that the beast of Revelation 13, which is the papacy, that the image to the beast that's formed at the end of the world is going to be the beast that we see the woman riding at the end of the world. That she's going to commit fornication with this beast at the end of the world. And the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth. If we take what, you know, Joseph Bates says about it, that eighth is the United States and is of the seven. So it's a Republican form of government that is the eighth, but yet it's going to make an image to the beast. And the 10 horns which thou sawest are 10 kings. So that's the United Nations, which have received no kingdom as yet. So we know that the United States is going to cause all the world to worship the beast and his image. So that's what this is referring to, the Sunday law. But receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. These have one mind and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. So in this context, we've defined that this beast, this scarlet-colored beast, is the eighth. It's the image to the beast, which is the United States making an image to the beast at the end of the world. So it's a much different view than we had of Revelation 17 in my whole experience as a Seventh-day Adventist. This view is new to me, but this is basically the pioneer's view, with just the addition of our understanding that we have in this movement. Now, we're going to close up here because we're definitely not done. We're going to have a lot more time to look at this. And I really appreciate all the questions.
Long shot.
Yeah. So, but I just want to go back to my chart again. So one thing that I didn't address here was, because we had looked at this earlier, but I just want to go to this. So one of the things we tried to do is we looked at the possibility that the seven heads or whatever could be understood in Odilio's study. Because remember, Odilio does the same thing. He's going to start, though, with Julius Caesar, and he's going to say five are fallen. And then he's going to place Nero as the one that is, because Nero burns down Rome on July 18th. And so he says Nero is Trump. And then Galba would be the seventh. Now, we looked at some of the problems with this. First off, we know that Julius Caesar is not an emperor, but he's just going to say the first seven Caesars. So he's not going to say emperors, because Julius isn't an emperor. Augustus is the first emperor. But the other problem that we have here is Augustus is the emperor at the time of the end. And to me, you need a time of the end in order to start the count. That's why we start with Reagan, because we're at the time of the end. Reagan's there at the time of the end. So you couldn't start a Julius if you're going to be following this as a reform line. We can see with the other kings, the other seven, the seven thunders we applied to these kings, we could see here that this wouldn't apply if we start at Julius. Now, if we go to Augustus and we count him as one, we're going to see that the five that are fallen, if you're talking in the context of John is in the time of... he's in the time of Domitian or somebody like that. He's not even in the time of Titus, because he's writing in like 96 AD, and Titus reigns from 79 to 81. And Vespasian is the one who's the king. He's the emperor when Jerusalem is destroyed, and Titus is his general, right? Titus, after the death of Vespasian, he becomes the emperor. But I've listed here these 10. And so there was a problem with Odilio's in trying to apply. You definitely couldn't apply the riddle correctly. Five are fallen, one is, and one is yet come, if we did that. Now, we also looked at the option that Galba, Otho, and Vitellius don't really count as far as the seven heads. But I still think what you would do is you could take the 10 horns when it comes to pagan Rome initially, as 10 emperors, possibly. But we don't really need this to understand Nero's significance. And one of the things about Nero, I'll just zoom in so you can see this a little bit better. But with Nero, the thing that's very interesting is the time of his reign. The 13th of October in 54 AD to the 9th of June in 68. And we know that this relates to our movement, that 126 days from June 9th, 2018 to October 13th, 2018, that 126 days that parallels Samuel Snow's letters that was used leading in to that 391 days that go to November 9th. So there definitely is symbolism here dealing with Nero, especially since Rome is burnt on July 18th. So we can see that all those things fit together. But I don't think you can take these seven emperors and apply it in the way that at least apply it directly as a prophecy. Now, you might be able to tie Nero then to Trump if you're going to count him as the sixth, or five are fallen, one is and one is yet to come, And then Galba would just represent Biden or something like that. But it just seems kind of a weak way of looking at it. So maybe there's something more that we can derive from this. And then the study, of course, dealing with the names of the popes, I found actually the most interesting. I know not everybody agrees with me, but the names of the popes, not the popes themselves representing seven heads, but the names of those seven popes that exist since 1798, with the one new one, which is Francis. So anyway, I know it's a lot of information. I recommend people read the paper by Bob Pickle. We're going to continue looking at this, but we're going to go a little bit more back into the past, dealing with the seven thunders. So these things that I talked about.
You have Pickle's paper on the email?
Well, you can actually link to it on the video. So if you go to the video on my YouTube page from last week, I have the link to his paper. So you can just do it that way. I also emailed it to everyone. But the easiest way
is probably... that's what I meant, if you emailed it. Yeah.
Yeah, I did email it. But it's probably for most people just easy to click on last week's video. So I hope people can see that, you know, there's a lot of work here. I mean, I haven't drawn really a lot of solid conclusions. I might sound like I have, but there's still lots of things I'm looking at and lots of things that we have to decide together as we go through this. And we will, once we get through some of this other history, we'll come back to Colin's paper and look at his arguments and see if we can make those fit with what God is going to reveal to us about Revelation 12, 13, and 17, etc. So anyway, any final comments or questions before we close with prayer?
A lot of questions, but we have to do that later, I guess.
Yeah, well, you can always email a question. So sometimes people do that. Some people contact me on Facebook Messenger. Some people, I actually prefer if people write on the comments on the videos themselves. So when you're watching a video, if you have a question, just type it in, because then that question that you have, other people may have, and that allows me to clarify that. So, you know, I'm always looking for comments on the videos. I do answer them. I check them every day. I don't always answer them every day. Sometimes I'm too busy, but I look at them every day. And so those are things that would definitely help other people, because questions are always about, if you have a question, even though it may seem like a stupid question, somebody else may have that question. So anyway, let's close with prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we are so grateful for the way that you have been leading this movement. And we know, Lord, that as we struggle through these different viewpoints, differences that sometimes we have, that you can help us to have the humility and meekness and lowliness of Christ, that we can be teachable, that we can learn in the school of Christ. Help us to be obedient to the things that you give us to do each day. And we pray, Lord, that this Sabbath will be a real blessing for each one. Continue to be present as we study, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.